Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, we're grateful for such a wonderful day in your house already, God. Thank you for the many things that have taken place, the salvations, the goodness of God, Lord, the times in your presence where we've gotten to lift our hearts and our hands in worship and praise to you. God, tonight as we open up your word, we pray that you would open it up to us. Open our eyes to see and our ears to hear, our hearts to have the good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Lord, tonight we don't look to a man or a woman, to the young or the old, the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. We look to you. Holy Spirit, you are the teacher of the church, so be welcome in this place. Be our teacher, be our guide, give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives, and Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. We would ask that tonight, God, that you would just speak your word, touch and heal and strengthen, encourage, guard, guide, and bless us, Lord, as we give our interest and our attention, do our part, Lord. We know that you'll do your part, illuminating the word of God into our hearts, and may it change the world that we live in, God, as we apply it to our lives. God, we don't just ask this blessing on ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, Lord. There are brothers and sisters. We love them. At no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else. But we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building one kingdom, and that's yours. So God, we ask that you would bless them as you would bless us this night, God. And also we had asked for those that are continuing in sorrow this week, God, those who have lost loved ones, God, recently in the attacks in our city, God, we pray that you would comfort and strengthen, God, that you would send laborers across their paths to minister your peace, your comfort, and your good news, God. And Lord, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say,
amen.
Amen. Well, tonight, get your Bibles out and go with me to the book of Matthew. We're going to launch out from the book of Matthew. I thought tonight, since we have the chairs on the stage, we would preach from Matthew to Revelation, just a short message tonight. And we would end with the thrones in Revelation. I'm just kidding. Tonight, I have a message, and I want to talk to you about a little message called Don't Be Afraid of Christmas. You know, there can be a lot of fear around Christmas time. What if I don't have enough? What if I don't have the right gift? What if I invite the whole family over for dinner and it's just terrible, you know? What if Uncle So-and-so starts opening his mouth again and somebody wants to punch him in his mouth or something? I don't know, you know? There's all sorts of things that can happen during this time. And oftentimes we approach the Christmas season with fear. Man, what, am I going to have to endure another holiday party at work? Am I going to have to fight the crowds at the malls? Am I going to spend too much? Am I not going to have enough? What's it going to be like? Many times we approach things, rather than looking at them with faith, we approach them with fear. You know, it's like when my son last year was jumping into the bathtub doing a cannonball, you know. It's kind of like a train wreck. You can't stop it, but you can't look away, you know. It's one of those things, and it's just going to happen. And I need to tell you, Christmas is going to happen, okay? So you need to let it happen. You need to be prepared for it. You need to be ready for it. And it's never safe to look into the future with eyes of fear, because you're going to get your expectation. If you think, man, it's going to be a terrible Christmas, guess what? You're going to end up having a terrible Christmas. Why? Because you expected it, and then you made it happen. But if you look to the Christmas stories, if you look to the narratives of the birth, you'll find that there was four do not be afraids that were spoken to four individuals. We're going to take a look at those do not be afraids tonight, because I believe that they have something for each and every one of us tonight. That as we look ahead to this Christmas season, as we look to the times that are going to be had, as we look to the encounters that are going to take place, as we look to the church services and the family gatherings, and that morning gathered around the Christmas tree or whatever that may be for you, that we can look ahead with eyes of faith, believing God for great things in our lives. Matthew chapter number 1, let's find out what the first one is tonight. Turn there with me to Matthew chapter 1. We're going to be in verse number 20 and verse number 21 to start out. First thing that we see is that don't be afraid to immediately obey God. The first don't be afraid we encounter in the Christmas narrative. Don't be afraid to immediately obey God. Matthew chapter 1, you got it? Verse number 20 and verse number 21 says this. It says, but while he thought about these things, here's Joseph. Here he is thinking about Mary. You remember the story? Joseph is betrothed to Mary. They were going to get married. And Joseph finds out that Mary is with child. Mm-hmm. And so Joseph is considering these things. He's wondering about them. He's thinking about them and thinking about what he should do. He had the right to drag her out into the center of town and have her stoned to death, killed. Because at the point of betrothal, they are legally married. And if she showed up with child, that would have meant that she was an adulteress. And so here's Joseph, and he's betrothed to Mary, and all of a sudden he finds out that Mary is with child. And he knows he didn't do that. And so he starts thinking about these things. And while he's thinking, he probably drifted to sleep, because we find that it says, but while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife. Everybody say, do not be afraid.
Do not be afraid.
Don't be afraid of Christmas. For that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. So he gets an explanation of what is going on. But now look at what it says. Verse 21, and she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Drop down to verse number 24. Take a look at what it says. It says, then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took to him his wife. Verse 25, and did not know her. That means that he did not have any sort of marital sexual relationship with her till she had brought forth her firstborn son. And he called his name Jesus. In other words, Joseph immediately obeyed the voice of the Lord when he woke up from that dream. He didn't wait. He didn't hesitate. He didn't stop to talk to his mom and dad. He didn't call his friends down the road. He didn't put it out on Facebook or do a survey or anything like that. No, he immediately obeyed the voice of the Lord. And for all of us, we need to not be afraid to immediately obey God this Christmas season. You know, many times when you hear the voice of the Lord, I don't know about you, but sometimes I'll hear God whisper something in my ear. You know, go do this. And you, I don't know, does this happen to anybody other than me? You kind of stop and you stand real still. Was that you, God? Okay, God, if that was you, say it again. Okay, God, all right, all right. If that was you, I'm going to open the Bible and I'm going to point at a verse, and if my finger lands on a verse that says what you told me to do, or it kind of looks like it or something like, then I know it's you, right? And what do? Judas went and hung himself. Dang it, right? But God is not looking for us to wait. When God speaks, we know that still small voice, don't we? It's that same voice that was wooing us, calling us at the moment of salvation, telling us, this is right. You need to do this. It's the same voice that you hear when you open your Bible and you start to read the Word, and all of a sudden the Word of God comes alive. See, the more you know the voice of God, when you hear the voice of God, now your response should be, yes, sir, amen. I'm going to go do it right now. Let me go take care of that, God. See, God's not looking for us to wait or to hesitate. See, throughout the rest of the accounts of Joseph, you'll find that he continued to immediately obey the voice of the Lord. When Herod was about ready to slaughter the children, Joseph was warned in a dream to go down to Egypt. Then when Herod had died, Joseph started to come back and he was going to go move to the area of Judea. And yet he was warned not to stay there because of the governor of the area. And so he went up to Nazareth. See, God had a plan. God knew that Jesus would be called a Nazarene. God knew the times and the season. He knew the scripture that he spoke through the prophet that said, out of Egypt I have called my son. Now, see, that had to happen through Joseph, because Joseph was raising a baby, a little child who couldn't take care of himself. And so Jesus couldn't go on his own down to Egypt. He had to be carried by his father and mother. And so God kept speaking things to Joseph, and Joseph kept immediately obeying God. And as he did, he got the God results. This Christmas season, I would imagine that God has desires, that God has plans, that God has something he wants to accomplish in your life and in your family and in your business place and in your neighborhood. And there are things that God has assignments for you to do. I would encourage you to condition your heart to hear the voice of the Lord. When you get up and when you read a scripture and you hear the voice of God through the word, when you're in prayer and you start to hear the voice of the Lord speaking to you about your day, giving you comfort and strength, and giving you God assignments, immediately obey the voice of the Lord. You know, oftentimes when we hear the voice of the Lord in my family is when we're about ready to give the freedom for our future pledge, or like the miracle birthday offering pledge. Anybody else hear the voice of God, right? God gives you a number. Oh my goodness, you get so excited about it, right? And you've been praying about it. You've been fasting, been getting ready. And then you come to the front row and you've got your commitment card, your pledge card in hand. And there you are. You're ready to bring it. You're ready to put it into the bucket or in the big trunks that we always put up here that year. And so you're excited about it. You got your number. You got it ready. And there you are in church service and the preacher starts preaching and you're hearing the voice of God. And all of a sudden, what does God say to you? Double it. What happens? I stand over there on the front row and I, was that you, God? If it was you, God, say it again. Right? And yet nothing. See, God doesn't want us to hesitate. God wants us to immediately obey. And so painfully, I pull out my pen, right? And I get out a new commitment card and, all right, here we go. I had faith for the other one, God. And yet we write out that doubling of the pledge, and we put it in there. And every time we've trusted God, every time we've obeyed God, God has supernaturally provided. God has made a way. God has done something. God has opened doors that no man can close. God has done something great. Same thing in your life. If God tells you, go tell them Jesus loves them. Go do it. Go do it. What's the worst that could happen? They could persecute you. They could laugh at you. Oh, well, at least you obeyed God. What's the best that could happen? The best that could happen is that they could say, he does. Why don't you tell me about him? Because I was just praying this morning asking God if he loved me. See, you never know the doors that God will open for you if you will immediately obey him and follow his voice. Don't be afraid of Christmas. Don't be afraid to immediately obey God. Second one is this. The don't be afraid that we see in the Bible. Second one that we see is don't be afraid of unanswered prayer. Have you ever prayed and asked God for something and God never answered that prayer? Have you ever asked God, God, I need you to provide, and you never saw the provision? I have. Can I be honest? I have prayers that I have been praying for years that I've not seen come to pass. And yet, we need not be afraid of unanswered prayer. Sometimes people say, you know what? I don't even want to ask because I don't want to be disappointed. See, it's just too hard. I've had enough disappointment in my life. I've had enough things go wrong. And at Christmas, the last thing I want to do is ask big from God and get little or nothing. This is a season of giving. You ever ask God for a gift? Right? God, if only this could happen this way. Right? God, if only you could provide. God, if only you could do something. And yet, I believe that many times we're afraid to ask big from God because we're afraid of unanswered prayers. But I want to show you a fear not in the Bible that will help each and every one of us with this. See, Zacharias and Elizabeth in Luke chapter 1, if you want to turn there with me, turn over to Luke chapter number 1. Zacharias was a priest. He had service that he had to do in the temple. Zacharias and his wife, the Bible says, were well advanced in years. You know what that means? It means they were old. Zacharias and Elizabeth had no children. And so here they are for years and years praying, asking God for children, desiring, wanting, and wondering, God, why? Why haven't you answered our prayers? But we see now, as we look back on the Christmas narrative, that we shouldn't be afraid of unanswered prayers. Luke chapter number 1, take a look at verse number 13. Here's Zacharias in the temple, and he must have been praying silently in his heart. And all of a sudden, the angel shows up. Look at what the angel says to him in verse number 13, Luke chapter number 1. It says, but the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zacharias. Everybody say, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. For your prayer is heard. Don't be afraid. If you hear this today and you've had unanswered prayers in your life, can this be the word of the Lord to you tonight? Don't be afraid, for your prayer is heard. God knows the inward secrets of your heart. And maybe you've never prayed it out loud, but you've had a prayer in your heart. God hears that fully. God knows that full well. And what does the Bible say? The Bible says that if we delight ourselves in the Lord, that he will give us the desires of our heart. Don't be afraid, for God has heard your prayer. Look at this. And your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. Wow. Here's John. He goes on to tell him how John will be a great man. He will prepare the way of the Lord. Now Zacharias opened his mouth a little bit too much, right? He should have kept the stuff in his heart, you know? But he opened up his mouth and he started saying, well, wait a second. How's this going to happen? We're old. Maybe you haven't noticed. We're well advanced in years. That's what the Bible said a couple verses ago, angel, right? And the angel says, no, you're going to be quiet now. That's just too much. And so he's silent until the day of John's birth. And here they're about ready to name him. And they're trying to name John, and they're trying to name him something else. And Zechariah's saying, no, 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 but he can't talk, right? So finally he says, let me write something down. So they give him a tablet to write on, and he writes, his name is John. And he shows it to him, and at that moment his mouth is opened up. But the bigger picture, the bigger story here, is that we need not be afraid of unanswered prayers. Here are a couple of people who were well advanced in years, who probably for decades asked God for something. And here comes the fulfillment at the end of their life. My goodness, we've been studying the book of Hebrews on Sunday mornings, and we've been reading about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who had promises from God of land, that everything that they saw would be given to them, that the land that they dwelt in would be theirs and their descendants forever. None of them received the promise here on earth, even though they may have asked God, God, hey, when is that going to happen? God, you said you were going to give me the land. God, why don't you just give me the land? And yet that wasn't a part of God's plan at that time. God knew what he was going to do with the children of Israel. And for each and every one of us, we need to recognize and realize that God's will is perfect, that his plan is complete, that God knows the times and the seasons and the reasons. Hello, come on, somebody. God knows what's going on in our life. And if God has not brought the prayer into your hands yet, just hold on, because God's going to do something amazing in your life. God knows when he's going to bring it about, what he's going to do, and how he's going to do it. There's a really neat verse in the book of Daniel, chapter number 10. Daniel was praying and asking God for some things. So Daniel starts to fast. He starts to seek God. For 3 weeks, Daniel gets nothing from God. 3 weeks, 21 days. He's praying. He's fasting. He's not eating anything that's pleasing to the eyes. And he's afflicting his soul and seeking for understanding because he had a vision. Suddenly an angel shows up to him and starts to speak to him, and he's trembling as the angel is speaking to him. And all of a sudden, look at what it says in Daniel chapter 10, verse number 12. I'll put it up on the overheads for you. It says, then he said to me, do not fear, Daniel. Everybody say, do not fear. Look at this. For from the first day that you set your heart to understand and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I have come because of your words. Church, you are not praying and your prayers are bouncing off the ceiling. That is not what's going on in your prayer closet. Your prayers aren't stopping at the walls. Your prayers, from the moment that you speak them, in fact, before you even pray them out loud out of your mouth, God already knows what's on your heart and knows full well what's going to come out of your mouth, because there's nothing hidden before God. All things are open and exposed to him. And therefore, God knows, God hears, and God is sending answers. Now, in the case of Daniel, there were some spiritual things that were taking place that hindered the response from coming at that moment. But yet Daniel tarried, Daniel waited on the Lord. I love what it says in the Bible, that even though, write the vision down that he may run who reads it. And it says, even though the vision may tarry, it will come to pass and it will not tarry. That's an amazing promise from God. Because there will come a time, church. There will come a place There will come a moment where what you've been praying and asking God for will come to pass. But don't give up on your prayers and don't give up on your God, because He is faithful and He is true. Pastor Richard, our youth pastor, prayed for over a decade for his dad to get saved. And there came a day that his dad came to church, heard the word of God, and gave his heart and life to Jesus. Pastor Richard also was praying for his brother to give his heart and life to the Lord. And there came a day and a moment, and I remember standing right over there and watching him come forward and watching Pastor Richard come forward with tears streaming down his face because his prayers were answered. Never let up on your prayers. Don't be afraid of unanswered prayers. Third one is this. Third thing that we say, don't be afraid of Christmas. And as we're not being afraid of Christmas, what do we see in the narrative? We see that we don't be afraid of the impossible. Don't be afraid of the impossible. Do you know that Christmas is a time of miracles? There were miracles all around at Christmas time. And sometimes, because we can't calculate how it's going to work, or because we don't know what God is going to do, we're afraid of the impossible. Oh, that couldn't work. That couldn't happen. You think that God could really save my whole family? I mean, they're a bunch of heathens. Maybe they've gone too far. Maybe they're too ragtag. Maybe you know, God tried and they were just too lost. But listen, nothing is impossible with God. If God can create a baby in the womb of a virgin, if God can bring all of the prophecies about Jesus in one man, then God can do the impossible this Christmas season. God wants to do miracles. God wants to do signs. God wants to do wonders. There is no sickness that's too great for our God. There's no need that will bankrupt heaven. There's nothing that is too difficult for God to take care of. No broken heart that's too shattered. No life that's too tore up. God is the mender of the brokenhearted. He binds together the wounded hearts. He will not break you. God will sustain you. He will uphold you by His righteous right hand. God is a God of miracles and the supernatural. And we need not be afraid of the impossible. So don't only be afraid to ask and maybe not receive it right away, but guess what? Don't be afraid to ask and receive it. Supernatural things take place when God comes on the scene. I had an instructor who I absolutely loved. He was a very funny guy. He was recounting a story of when he went to the hospital one time to pray for somebody. There in the hospital bed, he was looking at this guy who had wires and tubes coming out of every part of his body. And he looked at him and he thought, oh my goodness, this is just a hopeless case. And he didn't have much faith in his heart, but he knew that he needed to pray. And he believed in the power and the authority of the name of Jesus. And so there in that hospital room, he just took out his hand and he laid it on this fellow's chest. And he just said, in the name of Jesus. Now, much to his surprise, this guy in the sick bed with all the tubes, all the wires, all the machines keeping him alive, sat straight up and went, and took a deep, deep breath and started pulling at wires and things like that. See, there's nothing impossible for God. There's no hopeless situation when it comes to God. See, even a dead situation isn't dead to God, because we serve a God who raises the dead. Wow. Look at what it says in the Christmas narrative. You're there in Luke chapter 1. Drop down to verse number 30 and take a look at what happens when the angel starts talking to Mary. Luke chapter number 1, verse number 30, look at what it says. Here the angel speaks to Mary, greets her, tells her she's highly favored of the Lord. She starts to consider what sort of greeting this is. And look at what he says in verse number 30. Then the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. Everybody say, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. For you have found favor with God. Verse 31, and behold, you'll conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. Verse 33, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end. Man, I just get excited just reading the Christmas story, don't you? I'm preaching myself happy right now. Hopefully you are getting this too. Verse number 34, then Mary said to the angel, how can this be, since I do not know a man? Now I want you to notice what the angel speaks to her. He doesn't tell her, you're going to be quiet now. like he did to Zacharias. Why? Because Zacharias had examples in the Bible of people who were well-aged in years, right? Abraham and Sarah, 100 years old and 90 years old, had a baby. So Zacharias and Elizabeth should have been able to say, well, if God did it for them, he could do it for us. They had an example. But Mary had no point of reference. This was a new thing that was going to happen on the earth. And I believe her question wasn't a question of doubt. It was a question of wonder. How can this be? It was a question of marvel. This is impossible. So what's going to happen? So she says, how can this be, since I do not know a man? See, God had already made a man without anyone else, right? Without a mother. He created Adam. And he made a woman with the side of a man. Remember that with Eve, right? Put Adam to sleep. Created Eve. He created a baby and people who were beyond the age of childbearing with Abraham and Sarah. But God had never created a man in the womb of a virgin before. Verse number 35, and the angel answered and said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the highest will overshadow you. Therefore also that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Verse 36, he gives her a little infusion of faith, shows her something else that God is doing on the earth so that she starts to believe God even more. He says, now indeed Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age. And this is now the sixth month for her who is called barren. Look at verse 37. For with God, nothing will be impossible. See, don't be afraid. For with God, nothing will be impossible. Those impossible situations, those bills that you don't know how you're going to pay, those rascals of relatives that you have that you don't know how they're going to get saved because they have told you enough, don't preach to me. With God, nothing will be impossible. Now look at the response of Mary in verse number 38. Then Mary said, behold, the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. Wow. Wow. I heard a story of a guy that worked for GE, General Electric. General Electric was making light bulbs, and as a joke, they tasked their employees to create a bulb that was frosted on the inside. There was a guy who did not know that this was a joke. He was brand new to the company. His name was Marvin Pipkin. He had no idea that this could not be done in their eyes. It was impossible. And so he set to work, and not only did he find a way to do it, he found a emulsifier that actually was able to etch the inside of the glass and make it more stable rather than rigid and more unstable. See, in the natural, all we need to know is that God is greater than the natural. You don't need to know how it's going to work. And God is not trying to play some joke on us, getting us to believe the impossible like Marvin Pipkin, right? God is telling us, yeah, it's not doable in the natural. There's no way that you can make this happen on your own. But guess what? If we could do it on our own, we would get the credit for it. But that's why Mary says, from henceforth on, all will call me blessed. Why? Because God has done great things for me, she says. For each and every one of us, we need not be afraid of the impossible. Amen. Last one for tonight is this. Last one for tonight is this. Is don't be afraid to get saved at Christmas. Don't be afraid to get saved at Christmas. Luke chapter 2, turn there with me. Luke chapter 2. The angelic announcement to the shepherds, we see that we should not be afraid of salvation at Christmas time. Then the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. I want to talk to you guys in this room before you leave this place. I want to make sure that your heart's right with God before we let you go. It'd be a shame at Christmas time to talk about Jesus. It'd be a shame at Christmas time to listen to the Christmas narrative. And to assume that just because you came to church and just because you listened to the preaching of the Word of God, that your heart is right with God and that if you died, that you would make it to heaven and not go to hell. Now, sometimes people get offended at that term hell. They think, oh, well, you know what? That's just one of those radical things. That's just one of those weirdo things, you know, that people made up. It's like Santa Claus, you know, it's really your dad, right? The devil is really just a figment of parents' imaginations. And hell, that's just a story that's made up. But did you know that in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, God talks about hell? Jesus himself spoke of it. It's a very real place. And I want to make sure that if tonight was your last night here on the planet, that you would make it to heaven and not go to hell. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, all roads lead to heaven. You just do your thing, I'll do my thing. The churches out there, they have their own ways and their own things that they do. And as long as we stay true to ourselves, we'll make it to heaven because God appreciates the fact that we're trying and doing our thing. But can I tell you something? God is not into your thing. God is not into my thing. God's not into all the well-meaning church committees' things or their ways. Because God created the heavens and the earth. God wrote the plan of redemption. God carried it out in his son Jesus, born in a manger, born of a virgin. He lived the perfect, spotless, sinless life. And he went to a cross, beaten, bloody. And he died. He was raised again to life so that we could live with him. Do you think after he does all that, he says, yeah, whatever you want to do and whatever they want to do, and everybody can just do their own thing and I'll see it, and I'll just let them in now. No, he tells us exactly how to get to heaven in his word. There's one way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. What does that mean? That means it's God's heaven. We got to get there God's way. Sometimes people think, well, Pastor, that's good news because I know that God lets good people into heaven. I've been really good lately. Yeah, I used to be bad, but I cleaned up my act. Now I'm good. Done a lot of good things, helped out, given money to charities. I bought shoes that help kids across the world and drink water that digs wells in other nations. Gotten involved in social justice causes. Been nice to my neighbors and friendly. I've been really good. Doesn't that mean that I'm going to get to go to heaven? Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say how good you have to be? Do this much good and you get to heaven. There's no grading scale, no curve, no line in the back by the maps that you have to be above in order to get into heaven. You know how good you have to be in order to make it? Perfection. The standard is perfection. And no one is perfect except one whose name is Jesus. Now I'm going to ask no one to get up, no one to leave during this time. I want you guys to give me a couple more minutes of your attention, then we'll let you go. You've only been in church almost an hour if you were on time. Come on, we sit in longer movies than that. 2 hours, 3 hours, crossing your legs because you got to go to the bathroom, but you don't want to miss anything. And yet, we're talking about your eternity right now. Give me a couple more minutes of your attention, and I'll let you go. Some of you might be thinking, well, Pastor, I get it. Okay, we can't be good enough to get into heaven. But you know what? Not only have I been good, I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. Born in America, America's a Christian nation. They hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child. Went to religious classes like Sunday school or Sabbath school, maybe catechism class. And you know, not any other religions. Therefore, we're Christians headed for heaven, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents raised you in church, tell you're Christian, it makes you Christian? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you wear religious jewelry, be born in America, be baptized or christened as a child, because you attend religious classes, or that because you're not some other religion, that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven and denying your presence in hell. It doesn't work like that. So we say, well, okay, I get that. But you know what? Not only when I was a child did I sit in church. Here I am in church in front of you right now. I consider myself to be a Christian. That's great. I'm glad that you're here tonight. But you know that nowhere in the Bible says sit in church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. Nor in the Bible does it say that because you sit in a seat in a sanctuary and warm up a spot, that assures your spot in heaven. It's like me saying, you know what? I really want to be a Dodger. I drive down to Dodger Stadium in Los Angeles, buy a uniform at the sports chalet nearby, put it on, wear it, bring my bat and my ball and go sit in the dugout, call myself a Dodger, think that I'm going to get to play in the game. It was going to happen. They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out and lock me up. Why? Because I'm not a member of the Dodgers organization. Same way, you can't just sit in church service, call yourself a Christian, and abracadabra, magically, that makes you a Christian. So you're thinking, okay, I get that, I understand that, but maybe you don't get it. My last church, I got involved, helped out, sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible. I made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I even got a membership card to that church. It's great. I'm glad you did those things. But could you just show that to me in the Bible where you helped out, singing the choir, volunteer in church service? You get to go to heaven? Nowhere in the Bible does it see God is looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. It simply does not work like that. Someone needs to love you enough to tell you the truth. And tonight, I love you. I want to make sure that you go to heaven and not end up in hell. See, but Pastor, someone told me that all I needed to do to get to heaven is just know who God is. I know God. I know about Jesus. Celebrate the resurrection at Easter. Sing the songs at Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor, Old and New Testament. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian because I know who God is? Well, let me ask you this question. Have you read your Bible? Because your Bible and my Bible says the demons know who Jesus Christ is. They believe he's the Son of God. They're not Christians. The Bible records the devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. Not about having some mental ascent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. But rather, this is about your heart. See, Jesus has always been after your heart. And the way is not any of the ways that we discussed. Remember, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. See, Jesus was having the same conversation with a religious leader of his day by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a good guy, did a lot of good things, raised up in his church called the synagogue. He became one of the leaders, got involved, volunteered, helped out. He could quote the scripture, he could sing the scripture, he could debate the scripture. We would have thought if anyone knew God, it would be this guy because he was a teacher in Israel, taught people about God. He was an example for people to follow. And yet, when they're talking about this very same subject, Jesus doesn't just pat him on the back and say, Nick, man, hey, just keep doing what you're doing and I'll see you in heaven. No, rather, what does he say? He says, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. Now, I know, I get it. You guys have seen that on movies, television, read about it in magazines and the newspapers, saw it on a blog on the internet. Somebody was talking about born-again stuff. Looks weird, it's crazy, it's out-of-control Christianity. And yet, let's not let society, Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet define for us what being born again means. Let's find out from the Bible what it means. See, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, that's pretty gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. What's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, and occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything, and you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Maybe fear is keeping you back, and this message was for you tonight. Don't be afraid tonight to give God all of your heart and to give God all of your life. Don't be afraid to get saved at Christmas. It's all or nothing with Jesus, because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. It's what we find in the book of Revelation. And so tonight, I'm going to give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. I'm going to go one, two, three. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! Just like that. Woke you up, didn't I? When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Now you might be thinking, whoa, wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. But let's get over that. Let's push past that tonight. Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? No one would make that trade. Moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity away from God? Come on. And yet the devil is trying to talk you out of this right now. Trying to tell you it's okay to be afraid. It's okay because this is just emotionalism. This is not real. Or you have time. Listen, do you think that the people that woke up 2 Wednesdays ago, that were headed to the IRC for work, thought that they had more time? See, we are not guaranteed tomorrow. What you have is right now. Tonight, don't be afraid to give God all of your heart and to give God all of your life. Whatever's been holding you back, come on, push that aside, and let's go for God tonight. Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Tonight is your night. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this? Never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, get your hand up, and then you can come into the church service right afterwards or tell an usher. If you're online, wherever you're at, watching all over the world or across the nation, you're ready to get your hand up. God sees and God's watching you right where you're at. You can raise your hand. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me. There's one. There's two. There's three. God bless you guys. There's four. There's five. Got you over there. Five wise people already. There's six right there. Thank you. Seven. Got you over there. God bless you. Who else? There's eight right there. Got you over there. See, I didn't embarrass them, and I won't embarrass you. I think I got you guys. You can put your hands down. Thank you. Anybody else real quick? Hold on. Hold on. Don't clap. Don't clap. I'm fishing. You don't go clapping when somebody's fishing, right? You scare away all the fish. Anybody else real quick? Real quick. There's about eight wise people. If you need to give God all of your heart, need to give God all of your life, just raise it up high for me when I'm looking in your direction. Anybody else? Real quick. Listen, you won't be alone, and you don't need to be afraid to get saved at Christmas time. Anybody else? Anybody else? Real quick, come on. That's you. Raise it up high for me right now. Give me a wave if I don't see you. Anybody else? Last call. I'm going to wrap this thing up. Don't miss this opportunity. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about eight wise people. Amen. All right, all eight of you, or if you're number 9 and 10, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. It's not too late. Here's what I want you to do. In a moment, we're all going to stand, all going to give a clap, all going to give a shout. They're going to lead us in a little song. As they do that, we're all going to stand. We're going to welcome them as they come. That's your cue to get your stuff. Whatever you brought with you to church, coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front because we're going to change destinies tonight, but we can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand and welcome them. And if you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on down right now. Come on down. Come on.
Won't you come just as you are?
From the family rooms, if you want to bring your children, come on. They're welcome at this time. They'll remember this.
The Spirit
from the foyer, come on in right now. This is your time. This is your moment.
Just as you are.
You can come too.
Come and see.
Come on. Come on. Come on. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to take the first step.
Come and live forever. He'll give you life.
All right, I counted eight hands, and there's three people at the altar, which means that not everybody came forward. And listen, I just got to tell you something. Remember, we talked about don't be afraid to immediately obey God. If you heard the voice of the Spirit and it was good enough to raise your hand for tonight, then it's good enough to immediately obey the voice of God. Listen, God was delivering that word through me, but it was God speaking to you tonight. It was the Holy Spirit that showed you your need for Jesus as your Savior. And it was Him that you responded to by raising your hand. I'm not trying to trick you, not trying to coerce you or make a spectacle out of you by calling you forward. All I'm doing is I'm trying to help you in your walk with God. So I'm going to ask them to sing that one more time. And as they do, come on, don't be afraid to immediately obey God. Don't start your walk with God in disobedience, because if you can't walk a friendly, safe church service aisle for Him, what makes you think you're going to go out of this place tonight and live for Him? It's not going to happen. Fear will hold you back and it will cripple you from being everything that God has called you to be. So tonight, will you be bold? Will you be brave? And will you come right now? Come on, go ahead and sing that one more time. You come right now. If you raise your hand, you should raise your hand. They're coming. Come on, you can come too.
He'll give you strength for today. Just taste.
Anybody else? Come on down.
The living water, and you'll never thirst.
All right, all right. There you guys are. So glad that you guys came. Thank you for listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit. I want to lead you guys in a prayer, okay? We got like gobs of time, so I'm going to lead you guys in a prayer just to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again, okay? Brand new on the inside. It's an amazing thing that God does. I don't know what he does or how he does it. It's miraculous. This is a Christmas miracle for you guys, all right? And so you're going to remember this for the rest of your days, that during the Christmas season, I gave my heart and life to the Lord, okay? Now, we're all going to bow our heads. We're all going to close our eyes in a moment, and prayer is just simply talking to God. So I'm going to lead you in short phrases. We're all going to repeat this with you and say it out loud to encourage you. But if you have the ability to speak out loud, say it right out loud of your mouth. And really, it's about your heart going before the Lord at this time. Those of you guys that are watching on the live stream, if you raised your hand, you can join in this prayer as well. As I pray, you also pray and give your heart and life to the Lord. Let's all bow our heads. Let's close our eyes. And I want you to say this together with me. Say, Father God.
Father God.
Oh, come on, everybody join. Say, Father God.
Father God.
I come to you now.
In the name of
Jesus.
I give you
all of my heart
and all of my life.
Come into my heart.
Be my Lord
and my Savior.
Forgive me of my sin.
Wash me clean
from my past
and all the wrong I've done.
Give me a brand new heart
and a brand new start
in you, Lord Jesus.
And let it be known
that from this day on,
I am
a Christian.
I'm saved.
I'm headed for heaven,
denying my presence in hell.
Thank you, Jesus.
Fill me now
with your Holy Spirit
and teach me your ways
so I can live in them
for the rest of my days.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Come on, let's give the Lord a hand.
All right.
Man, you guys are born again. Welcome to the family of God. It's awesome. It's awesome.
Now listen, right over here to my right, your left, see this guy, he's being cool like me. He's got the scarf going. I wore mine because I'm freezing cold, but he wore his to be cool. So he's a really good guy. Really good guy. It's Pastor Joel, all right? He's going to do a couple of things. He's going to give you some free information. Now that you've prayed this prayer, now that you're a Christian, what do you do next, okay? It's free information, free literature. To find out exactly what it is, it's called Welcome to Your Destiny, Easy Steps to a Successful Future with God. Our founding pastor wrote it just for you, and it's just real simple reading. Maybe take about a half hour if you read slow, okay? Invest some time into finding out what to do next, okay? I'll give you a hint. Get back to church. That's one of the things that you can do, okay? Come hang out with your family, all right? Second thing he's going to do is he's going to talk to you about a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Basically, it's a friend in church. We all need a friend to come alongside us and encourage us in the ways of God, to describe for us what the Bible's talking about. Sometimes it can be kind of hard to understand. You need that friend, that spiritual personal trainer who can come alongside you and help you to find out some things out of the Word of God, out of the Bible, that'll help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back to your old ways, be in fear and bondage of the devil, right? That you can go on and live in the new ways of the Lord. So if you guys can make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel right this way, come on, let's give him a hand as they go.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.